the leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98Talk.com.
If you want to work until you keel over, have less of everything in retirement, or give back more of your hard-earned money to the stock market again, then just ignore me. But if you'd like to protect the money you save, receive a steady, predictable retirement income, and enjoy financial security for as long as you live, then listen to this. You can download a free report that reveals the wealth-building secrets Wall Street and the banks don't want you to know. You'll learn how you can get guaranteed growth, safety, and real prosperity without risking your money in the Wall Street casino, and how to get the money you need when you need it, simply by asking for it. This is the best way to have a 100% secure retirement and know your money will last as long as you do. To learn more about this method and to get your free report, go to 29security.com. That's the number 29security.com. 29security.com. Go to 29security.com.
This is Slickery Trigger for Rebel Road Tactical. With proper care and feeding, your pistol will be ready when you need it, there to save your life. Shouldn't your gear be that good? Whether you need a holster for comfortable everyday carry or a tough-as-nails holster for your next training course, Rebel Road Tactical has what you need. Check us out on the web at RebelRoadTactical.com.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
All right, folks, this is Rick Robinson with you. I want to tell you about some friends of mine from a company called Security Enforcement Specialists. When I ran my security agency for 12 years, I worked with one of these partners on a daily basis. He's been involved in this agency now, and with his other partner, they do have over 30 years of experience in the private security industry. If you own a business and you need someone to keep you or your customers or residents safe, then I highly recommend contacting Security Enforcement Specialists today. Give them a call at 405-703-1796. Again, that's 405-703-1796. Again, tell them Rick from K98 Talk sent you. Like I said, if you need the help, they are here for you. So make sure that you go look them up, check them out, and see what they can do. The wrong way. Welcome to the
place.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't going to be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Laura.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes. 800-471-3287.
800-471-3287.
The Internet will never be the same. You're listening to K98Talk.com.
Whoa! Good God, y'all!
What is it good for?
Absolutely!
Welcome to Voices of Global Freedom. We are broadcasting live from San Diego, California. This is your hosts, Backpack and Yoda. Backpack's helping carry your load, and Yoda bringing the force to patriots. We bring our audience actionable tactics, methods, and strategies to survive and thrive in these dangerous, troubled times. We are proud to be syndicated with Leading Edge Radio, K98, High Plains Radio, and SHR Media. Yoda, how are things today?
Things are great today. At least we're not in that terrible weather on the East Coast, are we? We are in San Diego.
That's a good point. We're seeing winter storm Jonas is burying major cities in snow. Blizzard warnings from D.C. to New York City to Cape Cod.
Well, after our national anthem, I want to do a shout out to a fond friend, a salute to a young, gorgeous, brilliant lady now stir crazy in her apartment in New York. Welcome back to that.
Yeah, we want to say hello to Claire Lopez, centerforsecuritypolicy.org.
Yeah, we'll get to it.
All right, so we'll kick it off with our national anthem, Star Spangled Banner.
Off you go.
Here we go.
And now to honor America, especially the brave men and women serving our nation in the Persian Gulf and throughout the world, please join in the singing of our national anthem. The anthem will be followed by a flyover of F-16 jets from the 56th Tactical Training Wing at MacDill Air Force Base and will be performed by the Florida Orchestra under the direction of Maestro Yaha Ling and sung by Grammy Award winner Whitney Houston.
Taint Hop present.
Ah.
hors d'oeuvre, parade, rep. This evening, to our coppers, firefighters, EMTs out there, from an old street dog copper, all the best tonight. Especially you East Coast men and women out there, be careful out there. The same stuff's going to be there later when you go home. Get home without tearing the knee in your trousers. Get home the same way you left, because the nonsense will be there tomorrow when you come back. More people are with you, first responders, in the home of the brave here, in land of the free so far, than you're aware of with the assault on police today. Now, that's spilled over to firemen now, anybody in a uniform. You guys and gals out there might overlook that the broad part of the silent majority were so with you. So, get home tonight, especially you East Coast people. Get home tonight the same way you went out. Be safe out there.
Now, we have the magnified view analysis of news you can use. Today, we have the Raspberry of the Week Award. Yoda, do you have a drum roll for us, our audience? Okay. Today's winner goes to Bill Gates. He has said that only socialism can save us from climate change. Breitbart. So that's our Bill Gates socialist commander-in-chief there from the West Coast.
My word, with that kind of money, you can be whatever you want, I guess. Notice how many of them do that? Stupid, really. Socialism is the door to communism. That's it. What else you got?
We also have breaking news about the abomination. This week, as the Obama administration announced it was lifting sanctions on Iran, Dahi Tamim, head of general security for Dubai, suggests that Obama's Shia roots helped him get elected in a bid to bring the United States and Iran closer. One of the most persistent theories in the Middle East is that not only is Obama a Muslim, he is a Shia Muslim, the Washington Post.
Boy, makes sense today. We hear that more and more, don't we?
True. There is that saying about the duck. If you hear a duck, it walks like a duck and talks like a duck. It is a duck.
It is.
The other one is our John Kerry, Secretary of State, admits helping Iran fund terror. And the question is paying ransom for the $1.7 billion was given to Iran to release our hostages out of Iran. The private sector is, according to this quote, so what are your thoughts about Mr. Kerry?
It is absolutely beyond comprehension that this blow-dried plastic dude stood up and said, in substance, the U.S. is funding ISIS. He was asked if he was aware that this billion, whatever it is going to terrorism. And he glibly said, oh, yeah, you know, sure, we're into that. Incredible. All right, my man.
We do have one quote from one of the most famous economists of all time, John Maynard Keynes. He said in 1927, 2 years before the Great Depression, we will not have any more crashes in our time. So we saw the greatest depression in 1929. And as we head into 2016, we're seeing a lot of buzz about the possibility of that.
Hearing a lot about it. Thank heavens we're hooked up with Todd Bubba Horowitz, our main power guy. He's the power broker in the finance industry. He's our main man. We're coming up with an article tomorrow about Bubba, our man, the finance guy, on our sister magazine, Millions Viewed, magnifiedview.com. Take a look at Bubba tomorrow.
Yeah, we just got an update from Lady Michelle in her chat room. As far as the blizzard, the storm, I asked her if everything's okay. She's good where she's at on the West Coast. She says most they've had is 4 inches and will change before February is over for sure. But so far, everything's good. We're good to hear that, Lady Michelle.
Welcome, our fond friend, Lady Michelle. Good to see you. Well,
yeah, thanks for joining us.
I moved here from Belgium on the English Channel, where a good day is rain, sleet, snow, and hail.
Oh, God.
Took me 2 months here in San Diego to become a weather wimp. Let's talk about our stranded, brilliant snow bunny in her apartment going stir-crazy in New York City, one Claire Lopez. Claire is a vice president of back then?
Center for Security Policy.org. And we have an update. For 25 years, the Center for Security Policy has pioneered the organization management and direction of public policy coalitions to promote U.S. national security. Even more important, the center's mission has been to secure the adoption of the products of such efforts by skillfully enlisting support from executive branch officials, key legislators, and other public dignitaries.
Claire breaks the mold. 22 years with the Central Intelligence Agency, where she was a covert operator. A bit on the anatomy of intelligence, the war of wits. About 95% of intel is collected through open sources, reading foreign government and foreign newspapers and listening to radio and TV and overtly just collecting stuff. About 5% is collected covertly, secretly, with what they call human intelligence. Mostly that's done through appointments at an embassy. So our CIA heroes and heroines work out of an embassy with diplomatic immunity. That means if they're caught, all that happens to them is they're kicked out of the country. Extraordinarily, our fond friend, who we raise a cup to tonight because she's stuck in her apartment. I can't picture that, but anyway, picture her stuck in an apartment. Anyway, she was a covert operator. She's one of a kind for 22 years. She is a unique source of information and for us and everybody. You can't be a little or a lot unique. It means she's unique, one of a kind. So we'll talk with her tomorrow. We'll get update on what's really going on. We're eager to get her back on, Backpack.
We are. We're always glad to have Claire Lopez on our show. It's an honor and privilege to work with her at Center for Security Policy as much as we can to get the word out of what's really going on in the world.
And they do. What's happening? What are we doing tonight, my man?
In this global age of terrorism, this radio show can literally save your life. World-renowned body language expert Dr. Lillian Glass teams up with Special Agent D. Vincent Sullivan, former head of the FBI Behavioral Science Unit Profilers, tells us how to spot Muslim terrorists on Voices of Global Freedom and his sister magazine, MagnifiedView.com.
This is a pair to draw to. This gal has taken, what she call it, body language?
She is the body language behavioral science expert.
Yeah, to the nth degree. She published a book they have together, they'll tell you about. She teamed up with an FBI agent who wound up heading up their profilers, properly called behavioral science. We recorded the show a few days or whenever. Anyway, it's a hell of a show. People will get a lot of information. Specifically on how to spot Muslim terrorists among us, should they be phenomenally unlucky, be in a soft target, a theater, a shopping center, a church, a school like that. She and the good special agent are going to lay out how to spot the bad guy. Fascinating, Backpack. And hats off to Backpack for finding these guests for us. I don't know how he does it, but oh, in addition, we opened up our second a week show. We're running a show now on Wednesday, 4 o'clock Pacific. So everybody, please come over and catch that show on Wednesdays. Lady Michelle, we need you over there if you have time on Wednesday. Go back there.
Yeah, well, great to see you. Lady Michelle and Mary has joined our chat room as well. Thank you for being with us today. We really appreciate your attention and everything, your support.
Hello, Mary. Make comments, ask questions like that. Welcome, Mary.
I got to make a quick statement before we go into our interview with Dr. Glass and D. Vincent Sullivan, former FBI, is that I just did watch the movie 13 Hours, and one of my pet peeves from the movie and just the reality of the world we're in is when they had a memorial for the people that died in the global war on terrorism. There's a new monument coming up in D.C., it really should say Global War on Islam Terrorism, to be specific. They're trying to be all politically correct, but we are in a global war on Islam terrorism. Let's just speak our minds and tell what's really going on.
Thank you, partner Backpack. It looks like Comey, current head of the FBI, is coming out with the Hillary the Hun server nonsense. You heard recently that she knowingly blew out compartmentalized above top secret information for her own purpose.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. She's won the Raspberry Award for the last 2 weeks in a row for Magnified View. I think she gets the Century Raspberry Award for what idiocy she did, giving away these secrets. We just heard from Fox News, that guy Morton Storm is on Fox a lot, and he mentioned, too, the risk that she put so many of our agents, our brave agents that keep us free, was outstanding, unbelievable.
Truly, well.
Wow.
Don't we have so many friends retired and current with the FBI? We hold them in the highest respect. They are heroes and heroines. And I am supremely confident with their thoroughness. They are on Hillary the Hun like white on rice. They will wrap her up. Our information, well, I guess it's public now. They've also added to their ridiculous server thing, they've added the foundation. So she may hit a little room, I don't know, for a lot of time to think about this. I doubt that Lynch will go ahead with the prosecution. Some of this clearly points to the abomination. He's not going to permit that. But I'm hoping for the best with that, Backpack.
Yeah, we want to hear from you. So if you have thoughts, speak your mind about the whole Benghazi disaster, 13 hours, and Extortion 17, and many of the other hotspots that the Obama nation's done, including giving Iran the entire Middle East now, is what we're seeing.
Did they call in?
Yeah, call in 646-652-4667, 646-652-4667. Every Saturday and Wednesday from 4 to 6 p.m. Pacific, you can call in and reach us on that phone and talk to Yoda and Backpack.
Join the conversation.
Join the conversation. Here's our interview with Dr. Glass and D. Vincent Sullivan.
Hell of an interview.
Yeah, it is.
Welcome to Voices of Global Freedom. We have a special edition, a tag team today. We are in this global age of terrorism, and there's a new book, fairly new book from 2012, The Body Language of Terrorists Protects Yourself and Those Around You by Spotting Signals That Identify Potential Terrorists. We have on the line with us world-renowned, well-respected body language expert, Dr. Lillian Glass, and author of best-selling Toxic People, teaming up with D. Vincent Sullivan, former FBI special agent and head of the Behavioral Analysis Program and FBI Joint Terrorist Task Force. Yoda, how are you doing?
I am fascinated with the guest you drummed up today. Good morning, Dr. Glass. If we were any better, we'd have to take heaven for it.
That's a wonderful thing to say.
Well, it's true. I'm 78 years young and the luckiest guy in the world. Special Agent Sullivan, how are you, sir?
I'm doing just fine. Glad to be here with you.
We're delighted. Our conservative patriotic audience is really interested in what you've got to share with us. Dr. Glass, how did you come about this body language expertise?
Oh, well, I've been doing it for many years, and, I started out in speech communication, psychology, and kind of been all blended together. I had a practice in Beverly Hills for many years and taught celebrities different speech communication skills and body language skills for the roles that they did. And all of that combined started to get me known on the talk show circuits, and then I was featured in magazines in terms of what I did, analyzing celebrities, politicians, especially during election times, and that's how I became to be known as a body language expert.
Tell us a little about it. What should we be looking for in this world of Islamic terrorists?
Well, there's a lot of signals, and one of the things that Special Agent Sullivan and I of terrorists, and we looked at countless material, and we came up with patterns, and we found that there's four different emotional states that a terrorist tends to experience or tends to manifest. One can be numbness, so many of the body language characteristics that go with that. One can be anxiety. One can be anger, or anxiety and nervousness. One can be anger. And so there are many signs that we look at. One of the things that we can just start off the bat are the walking in single file. And if Vince wants to talk about that for a moment, that would be great.
Yeah, we find that very often the 9/11 hijackers did this, and the Sarnaya brothers did it, in order to not look like they are a team on a mission, they will walk, as Dr. Glass said, in a single file. And that was one of the striking things about the Sarnaya brothers, even though there were just two of them. They were walking at the same pace, and the younger brother was just a few steps behind. And despite their attempt not to look like they were together, they did look like they were together, and they did look like they were on a mission.
We've seen that, Mr. Sullivan, with gang behavior as well. They walk in a single file, 8, 9, 10 of them, and it appears less than were they to walk abreast, of course. I am dying to hear more, the audience is, Backpack is, about behavioral science. Tell us about that, if you will.
Well, behavioral science is the cutting edge, and it has been for some time, but it's the cutting edge of law enforcement efforts, and it's very important to reading people and not just, we all watch the CSI programs, and they are fascinating, and we've made huge strides to be able to forensically prove with DNA and other forensic tests who did something. But we're talking about preempting or preventing things from happening, and that often is a function of being able to see what someone's about to do something nefarious before they do it. And this is becoming ever more important, and it's one of the reasons we want to get this book out. This book is for everyone, but we hope that it will be received and read by the citizenry worldwide, because law enforcement has its hands full, and they now need us to help them. We have Amber Alerts all over the world, or all over the country, to augment law enforcement effort, and now we hope that our book will make smarter citizens that can augment the law enforcement effort.
And if I could just add to what Special Agent Sullivan said, it's very interesting because we really want to, this book is in the hands of a lot of law enforcement people. The FBI has it. And so we really wanted to expand it to the general population. And it's an easy book to read and shows photographs. And it can really save your life if you listen or look at a lot of the tips that we have in the book. It can literally save your life. And that was what our aim was. You know, so many of the politicians right now are talking about being vigilant. Our president is discussing be vigilant. All of the candidates have mentioned in the debates, be vigilant. But what do you be vigilant about? What are you looking for? And this is the book that tells us what.
Tell us, Doctor, the name of the book, where we can find it.
It's called Body Language of Terrorists. Body Language of Terrorists, and you can get it on Amazon. It's a Kindle edition that we have. We have an actual paperback edition, and you can also we talked about men, women, and we asked people to pick out the carrots. We had about 30-something photographs, and no one got it correctly that they picked out the carrots, because they're tall, blonde, blue-eyed carrots that look like myself. There are carrots that look like Mr. Sullivan. There are very good-looking carrots that look like Brad Pitt. In fact, one of them is to Mr. Boyd, is in prison for the rest of his life for what he did, and he does not look like a typical terrorist. We see black terrorists, especially from Somalia in the Minnesota area. We see Asian terrorists, Jemaya Islamia. We see so many different cultures of Latin terrorists. So you cannot say that somebody is a terrorist because of the way they look and because of the way they appear or how they dress. It is strictly about behavior, and that's what we're about.
This would apply to criminals as well, would it not, Dr.?
Absolutely. And I think Mr. Sullivan can address that even better, because he certainly has spent his lifetime dealing with the criminal element.
I have as well.
The body language we're talking about is the body language of people who are about to do something bad. And as you point out, just as well, a gang member, a lone actor, but this is just a common garden variety criminal. So when people make themselves astute and aware to observe what's around them and get in their arsenal some of these observational data points to look for, they may find that they're making themselves safer, not just from terrorism, but from many other things that they could run across just moving around in our larger cities. And it's stuff that cops use. It's stuff that, well, I spent almost 20 years in New York. Every New Yorker is a pretty good people reader, and they know how to look for these things as well and to avoid trouble.
What was it like working with Rudy Giuliani in New York?
Well, as you might expect, we like aggressive prosecutors, and Rudy was definitely that.
We're having an FBI week. Who are we recording tomorrow, back then?
Tomorrow we have Ron Hosko, who is the former assistant deputy director of the FBI. He'll be coming on our show.
Do you know him, Mr. Sullivan?
No, we do not.
Yeah, we're recording him tomorrow. Personal question. How did you choose agents in the behavioral science? What were you looking for?
Well, we were looking for good investigators, and there are many attributes that make someone a good investigator, because in the behavioral unit, the science unit, or analysis unit, we are aiding investigators in their investigations. So if you don't have a good feel for investigations and how to do them, you won't be much help, even if you have some behavioral training and knowledge. We did not require it, but we were happy to bring on board anybody that did have advanced degrees in any of the behavioral sciences. And then when you work with people, you can kind of tell people who are good at sizing other people up and have some of these attributes that we are able to spot, these attributes we're talking about in the book. And when we found those kinds of people, we invited them to come on board, and we would give them additional and more training. But we wanted people who were interested in human behavior and had a knack for analyzing it.
I've seen that in law enforcement for the past 50 years around the world. Some of the officers and agents are good at it, and some could be better at it. We're certainly going to promote your book throughout radio and our sister magazine, MagnifiedView.com. Dr. Glass, tell us what we should be looking for as ordinary, run-of-the-mill, daily citizens. What should we be looking for?
Of liars, and control and made the headline that Obama is a psychopath. And that is very dangerous to make that statement. And thank goodness Snopes contacted me and we got to the bottom of it and said that, you know, of course I never said that. And it was a very scary association to call somebody such a severe name just based on one bit of information. That's where a little bit of information can be very dangerous. So we're looking at clusters here. It's very important to look at things. And, you know, one of the things in the San Bernardino terrorist attack that just happened recently, it's very important to know that the survivors noticed the severe agitation of the terrorist whose last name was Farouk. He was so agitated and nervous and angry. And that's one of the things you have to look at, because it's anger that's above and beyond the normal anger, and it wasn't appropriate. Another, the Paris terrorists noticed that there was dripping, that the survivors noticed that the beards of the terrorists were dripping with sweat. So over, that's something you really need to look at. If somebody's sweating in a climate or in a situation where you shouldn't be sweating or having that so severe of a reaction. Clothing is very important. A lot of times parents will wear multiple layers. They will hide their weaponry there, or they'll wear a coat or a jacket that is not appropriate there that we're looking at. So that can be something to examine. And we have to look at all different things, how they're patting each other. In fact, Mr. Sullivan can talk to that a great deal, and in terms of how one looks at weaponry, how one can tell if somebody has a weapon on them.
Yeah, I just wanted to tag on to what Dr. Glass said about multiple indicators and give you an example of one incident that utilized that. In 1999, the millennial bomber Ahmed Rassam was trying to cross the border at Washington State, and an alert border agent noticed three things about him that caught her attention and caused her to detain him further and question him further, and then eventually search the car and find the bomb components. One was that he was sweating, and as Dr. Glass said, it was inappropriate to the weather. There was no reason to be sweating, but she could see the beads of sweat on his upper lip. He was, speech-wise, he was incoherent. And we talk about this in the book, that sometimes when you are on a mission and you were very concerned about executing the mission, there's a cognitive load on your brain which will interfere with other seemingly normal tasks, such as speaking coherently, and he was unable to speak coherently. And then the third thing was his eyes. He wouldn't make eye contact with her. So she put those three things together, and given the fact that it was a border crossing, so she's looking at context, she then detained him further and saved us all from a bombing. So that's what Dr. Glass is talking about when we're talking about clustering indicators, not just one, but looking at a number of them. As far as weapons go, almost all of the teams in urban areas in law enforcement are trained to watch for telltale signs of people carrying weapons. Obviously, shoulder weapons, rifles, are pretty hard to disguise. So, and that's kind of the weapon of choice, it appears, right now. And so when they get out of a car, they're usually, or at any vehicle, they're usually presenting that weapon. And so that's a very obvious tell when you see somebody with a rifle. But other times they have tried to cover them up with long coats. And sometimes they will do this, even in weather where long coats are not called for. I noticed that the latest shooting in Philadelphia, if you look at the striking pictures of the shooter, he was wearing some sort of a long coat or garb, which I think was striking. It was white. And I'm not saying it was inappropriate to the weather there, but it would have caught my attention. And then if someone is not familiar with how shooters shoot, it would be worth familiarizing yourself and maybe even taking a shooting course, because when you present a weapon, either a handgun or a rifle, there's a distinctive stance that is taken and a presentation with the arms outstretched. And you can see that in the Philly stills of the shooter approaching the cop car. Now, granted, anybody seeing that would only have seconds to do something about it, but and I don't know that the policeman who was shot did see it before of seconds before it hits.
We work closely with customs. Our hats off to that gal you mentioned up north at the ferry. It was late at night. It was drizzling up there. I imagine she wanted to get home. It was the last ferry. Yet she still did her job. I'm really proud of that gal, people.
Yeah, I will say, too, and I might get in trouble for saying this, but you mentioned who do we want on behavioral teams. Women tend to be keen observers of the people in front of them. They are much better observers of what somebody's wearing, and they're often more observant of facial expressions and so on. So I don't know if it was because she was a woman, but she definitely was doing her job, and we owe her, as you said, a great debt.
We were customs officer and I, some of them are uncanny in their ability to spot the bad guys. They just are.
I just want to add, so are people that work at the airport, because we mentioned a security guard at the airport thwarted a possible attack because he noticed some people walking in single file and he was very suspicious. And then we also see that there was a desk agent who, this fellow Richard Reed, who we all can now thank for having to take off our shoes when we go to the airport, shoe bomber, this fellow was disheveled and stinky and not well groomed, and he was mumbling his words. And so the ticket agent said, you know, I'm not going to sell you a ticket, but he ended up going the next day. So he was supposed to be on a flight the day before. So, you know, you see that there are people from all walks of life that have thwarted this type of behavior. And one of the things we encourage people in the public to do is if you see something, say something. One of the most talented actors, James Woods, was on a flight, and he noticed that there was some strange behavior with his fellow passengers. And this, perhaps you can discuss that in more detail.
Yeah, that flight was 1 month before our infamous 9/11 attack, and James Woods, who by his own account is a people watcher, was watching. He was on a flight from Boston to L.A., and earlier you asked the question, you know, what should we be looking for? And it's most elemental, well, what we should be looking for are things that creep us out or things that are not normal in the context we're observing them. And I know that's a very broad statement, and what does that mean? Well, it's kind of like the old Supreme Court definition of pornography. Can't define it, but I'll know it when I see it.
Right.
So Woods noticed something. He actually noticed, again, a cluster of things, about four of the passengers, that he thought was very unusual for transcontinental travelers, which he did all the time. And he, for instance, they never went to the bathroom on a five-hour, six-hour flight. They didn't get up out of their seats. They didn't eat anything. They didn't sleep. They didn't read anything. They didn't watch a video. They talked to each other in hushed tones, and they treated the first class flight attendant like she was dirt. This all caused him enough concern that he brought it to the attention of the first class flight attendant, and who then in turn alerted the cockpit, and they assured him that they would take active measures. Now, when he got to L.A., nothing happened that month, but it would turn out that he had seen a dry run for 9/11 and was able to identify several of the 9/11 hijackers. That's all because he was watching and he saw things that didn't fit the context he was very familiar with. When people fly from Boston to L.A., there are things they do and things they don't do, and these guys were breaking all the rules.
Permit me to be a little academic. Our biggest enemy is denial and repression. Our audience and others deny that it's happening or going to happen, and they repress it's going to happen to them. An amazing tragedy the other evening in San Diego. Poor guy with his gadget, cell phone or whatever, walks right off a cliff and falls 40 feet to his death. So how do we get people moving their heads around? How do we get people to be vigilant? That's our biggest challenge on Voices of Global Freedom and Magna. permit me a Yoda anecdote. It's like an anecdote. We responded one night to an armed robbery at a remote ATC in a bank in the middle of nowhere about 11 at night. Victim had called in, middle-aged Caucasian male with his young son. So we arrived, and there he is with stuff in his ear, some kind of earphones, and he's got a gadget in his hand, and on and on. He was robbed at knife point by two guys. And the first thing he told us is they came out of nowhere. My partner backpack actually had to stifle a laugh. He wouldn't have seen an elephant in the damn parking lot. Dr. Glass, address this, if you will. How do we get people to move their head around a little bit? I know it's academic.
I think it's just awareness. I think that's the first thing. You know, just knowledge is power. And I think that we need to educate people on what to look for. And I think, you know, like if you have the kids that are going away to school, to college, if you have even kids in high school, this is a book that they really need to read to be aware. There were some wonderful young men that were on the train. They were in Paris, and they thwarted a terrorist attack. They were amazing because they were aware, they were vigilant, they felt something was wrong, and they subdued five of these young guys, subdued the terrorists. So, you know, we live in a strange time where people are so hateful and so hostile and so angry and scary, and they think of nothing. They think nothing of killing masses of people. One of the things we did for the book, and it's not a pleasant thing to say, but it's something that we did, is we looked at the suicide bombers, the body language of suicide bombers, and we saw that after they were blown up, we saw the remains, that many of them were smiling, and we even showed photographs of that in the book. There were some of the body bombers who were going to their execution were actually smiling. Maybe they think they'll meet the 72 virgins, maybe they'll think they'll be honored, but whatever it is, it's such misguided information, and we're really dealing with this type of mentality oftentimes.
We indeed, as backpack professors, they live in the 7th century. I've operated throughout North Africa and Malinta. They're serious. You cannot be a Muslim with a small M. You can be a Catholic with a small C, take your mother to Mass on Easter. These people are conquering our civilization in the caliphate, as they have in the past. I've met with them, and they're not playing. They are serious about it. The new element in my meager experience in counterterrorism is the suicide component, Mr. Sullivan. What do you say?
That'll be a good one.
Yeah, my father was in World War II, and we kind of have to hearken back to the kamikaze pilot to go back to another ideology that had that component to it, and we struggled with how to address it then. In the book, some people say, well, how are you going to, they ask us, how are you going to know that somebody is going to kill us? Well, even if someone is on a suicide mission, they're going to exhibit various biological tells, and we go over a number of them in the book. And so there is something to be read there, and there is a way to then thwart them. In the Boston bombing, there was a kid, I call him a kid because I'm so much older, there was a guy that lost his legs, both of them, just above the knee, and he saw the older Tsarnaev brother walking briskly. And here again, as with James Wood, the older Tsarnaev brother caught his attention because he wasn't doing what everyone else was doing. Everyone else was watching the finish line and watching their loved one or friend finish the race. And then after that, they were all getting together, hugging and smiling and talking. But here was a guy who wasn't watching the race, who was walking briskly, and had a look on his face, according to Jeff Bauman, the young man that I mentioned,
overreacting. And of course, moments later, he loses, or at least sustained injuries that will cause him to lose his legs. So it, again, as we say in the book, and now the older Sarnaev brother was not on a suicide mission, but even if he had been, those same tells were all there. And unfortunately, Jeff dismissed it like a lot of us are wont to do, and we, as a nation, as a society, we have stopped doing that.
And you know, I also should add something to that, as Mr. Sullivan was saying about observations. The Israelis are probably the best at detecting various tells or something is off. And one woman came in, she was dressed in a abaya, she was, you know, from the, covered from head to toe in black, but yet something was off. She was allegedly pregnant, but she was not walking like a pregnant woman. Usually pregnant women walk like they waddle from side to side to protect the baby, protect themselves from not falling down. But she was walking with one foot directly in front of another. And that was very suspicious to one of the guards and the Israeli guards. And she was busted. She had a suicide belt on. So, you know, we have to be just so vigilant in this day and age and trust our instincts. And that's something we really have to discuss, which is instincts. You know, we are so biologically programmed to know if something is right or something is wrong. And the instincts deal with what we see, what goes on to our visual cortex in our brain, and what we hear, the auditory cortex. And it's all filtered into a place in the brain, in the middle of the brain, called the limbic system. And that limbic system is very important because it deals with emotion. It translates things into emotion. The fight or flight response. Something's not right. I don't like this. We have to listen to those emotions. If you feel the hair on your neck stands up, if you feel queasy in your stomach, if something doesn't make you feel good, listen to that. Listen to that, because that can save your life.
Fascinating. I would add that we find that kids are excellent observers as well as the female of the species, Mr. Sullivan. I've seen kids around the world that are really observant and eager to tell you what they see. A quick example, we had a terrorist act in Costa Rica with an assassination and execution and running around. We found a kid who said, oh, the lady wasn't jogging here. She was really writing things down. And that led us really to the lady terrorist. Give us some bullet points, Doctor, if you will, that we can look out for. And we need the name of the book again. A lot of our audience is standing in the kitchen and they're driving cars. So need to get the book out there.
Yes, it's called The Body Language of Terrorists, just Body Language of Terrorists, and it's written by Lillian Glass and D. Vincent Sullivan, and it is so important that people pick a copy of this up. You can put it on your computer with Kindle, but some of the signs we can look for are signs that, for example, the numbness. You know, if somebody has unusual mask-like expression, like the Mumbai bombers had, if they have they're having rhetoric that's out of control. We saw this with Nidal Hassan, and people complained about it. They said, you know, what is going on here? Why is he talking like this? And nothing was done, unfortunately. Or we see people that have had that in the San Bernardino bomber or terrorist. They were also, Mr. Farouk was having these discussions and debates with people that were very hostile, as he had this rhetoric, passionate rhetoric about that was very foreign to many people. So when you see people like that, you know, you have to listen, you have to look, you have to be aware. And there's so many tells we talk about in the book, and you know, would be unfair to just, you know, mention every single one of them in isolated context. But we look at things, you know, from this, what happens to a person's skin, what happens to, you know, do they flush, do they blench, what happens, do they lick their lips, do they shake their heads, do they have uncontrollable shaking, or do they all of a sudden raise their arm. When a person has this kind of automatic response, that's a very big danger sign that some severe activity is going to be taking place that could be detrimental to your life. So, you know, we talk about things and we let people
soft interview. If an interview is a conversation with a purpose, then the soft interview is a parent just talking to their kids about what happened today at school, what was the most interesting thing that happened. And as you say, out of the mouth of babes will often come astonishing truths or observations that wouldn't have been made because you didn't ask. But if you give a child a chance to tell you about their day, you may hear a child say, oh, well, we all saw this car with two guys in it that were taking pictures of the school ground. We thought that was pretty unusual. Now, they may not have told that to anybody, and they may not have thought that it was worth mentioning, but now you've asked what their day was like, and now they tell you. And now you, the parent, can then take some action from there. But that only comes if you're having conversations with your children and asking them about what they saw, what did you do, and so on.
Voices of Global Freedom, MagnifiedView.com. We're talking with D. Vincent Sullivan, former FBI special agent, and Dr. Glass. They are co-authors of Body Language of Terrorists. Two-part question is, one is, how did you two come together to write this book? And you've also got in your book, never before presented research analysis revealing visual, auditory cues as well as behaviors essential to identifying the most dangerous people in our midst. So, yeah, if you can tell us how you met and how what your research.
Well, we met when David Sullivan called me up as the head of the behavioral analysis program at Body Language. And then we saw that we had so much in common and had a very common view of life and people and how people are perceived. And we realized how important it was in this day and age to join forces and to write a book together on the body language of terrorists using his incredible background and incredible expertise. I mean, I know he's being humble, but he's one of the brightest FBI people that has ever been out there. He's amazing. And, you know, myself in my area of body language, and we combined resources and combined our experiences and came up with this book, and we're so proud of it because we feel we're doing a real justice to society.
You are, Doctor. You are indeed. Backpack earlier mentioned our stunning guest lineup, of which you bear a part, of course. Admiral Lyons, General Vallalee, General Flynn, DIA, on and on and on. And on air with us and off air privately, they're all predicting active shooters in this year, a lot. They can't quantify how many or where. They're also predicting large bombings throughout the country. Their reputations are on the line. Finally, General Flynn, close friend, ran an agency, as you know, about a third bigger than the CIA. He's predicting a tragic chemical attack on a major city. So it's these folks and Claire Lopez, 22 years CIA, on and on and on. So we're looking for active shooters this year. It's not hypothetical. We're relying on our sources, such as you folks, and we're anticipating bombings this year here in the United States. So we feel your book is vital. We're going to help you get it out there.
Thank you so much, because it will save so many people, not only in America, but around the world, when they're aware of these things. And it can just be such a simple thing that they look at. And, you know, when we hear these signals, see something, say something, sometimes you have to do something. And that means run, hide, leave, you know.
Take a look when you get a minute at the MagnifiedView.com. In the simplest terms, we explain what to do if you're caught in a situation like San Bernardino. Mr. Sullivan's background is indeed exactly as you said. It's extraordinary with the FBI. We've worked with the FBI older than a rock. I worked with Julius Caesar when he was a corporal. I worked closely with the FBI. And Brother Sullivan's track record is extraordinary, actually.
I have to say, I really can say that. And knowing him, he is just so sharp and so amazing. And, you know, he really did some wonderful things for his country.
Nice and humble.
Dr. Glass. Yeah, Dr. Glass, I wrote that a little differently, but you got most of it in your
head. That's funny. He's being helpful, but he is amazing.
We've got to meet in person, Dr. Glass. We're down the road. You know, we're at the corner of Camp Pendleton. I wish.
Oh, great.
Wish Special Agent Sullivan was out here closer. Meanwhile, backpack. I think we should run this as a series. What do you think?
Yeah, this has been really good. What are some of the things to look for in soft targets like theaters, schools, and churches? How should people be more vigilant?
Well, I have my heart
I noticed in your book, Body Language of Terrorists, that you talk about the four emotional states of terrorists. Can you speak more to that?
Yes, there's different emotional states. And what we talk about is the numbness. You will see that not with all terrorists, but with a lot of them. Many of them don't want to do this terroristic act, and many of them are given drugs. They're given various types of narcotics, and we talk about the different narcotics and signs to look for with narcotics. And you can see this really readily with bombers, and we show pictures of how they have this mask-like appearance on their face. They're so much joy, and they're numb. And then I have an interesting photograph, which is a comparison of the Mumbai bomber when he's in court and he's not drugged up, and then when he's in an altered state. So many of them are in an altered state. You know, a lot of these terrorist organizations, they prey on the very poor. They'll take young guys who have no future and offer them this wonderful honor of being a terrorist. Many of them don't want to do it. We also studied the tapes, the suicide bombers' tapes, the last will and testament, and most of them did not want to do this. When they read their mission, you could see the fear come over their faces. They did not want to do this. One of them, Jarir, who's one of the suicide or one of the 9/11 terrorists. You see him lip-licking, you see him looking down, smiling, scratching his head in a very thick mask-like smile. He's just so upset that he knows he's going to his death. He's finally realized it. It may sound ideal, you want to please people, but when you're reading that last will and testament, it is scary, and these men realize that. So, you know, we're seeing that altered state. We see a lot of anger, agitation, people that are angry at the world and hate everybody, kind of like the Nadal situation. And so, you know, you're really dealing with this myriad of emotions that isn't appropriate for the situation. And that's when you really need to look at your instincts and trust them with regard to what you observe in the body language, et cetera.
Do you folks, are you keynote speakers? Do you give classes?
Yes, we're starting to do that, and we're absolutely getting involved in that in a very big way across the country.
Have you gotten the book out to law enforcement?
That's our next step. You know, with many of them have it, we're going to really get, thank you, you're asking wonderful questions, and that's exactly what we're doing on our mission. Our book just came out, actually, last week, the week before that, I should say. It's about 10 days it's been out, and so we're just so excited about it. It's like, it's something that we have been working on, and it's finally materialized, and we have all the information in it, we're proud of it, and it will save lives, and we are going to make it available to every police officer in the country.
Be informed that we're with you. We're non-monetized. I find that a cool way of saying we're independent as pigs on ice. We do this for love of the mission and out of it, you know, it's what we do. So we're not beholden to anybody. We do as we damn well please. We don't have advertisers. So we will be promoting you guys in the book. It's a noble, righteous thing you're doing. It needs to be done.
Thank you. And we feel the same way.
A lot of nonsense out there today, as you're well aware, these program hosts that hear themselves talk all the time. We're going to respect your cutoff time here, Doctor. What time is it, Becca?
10:37.
Yeah, in the book, Body Language of Terrorists, talk about the profiling. That's always a big issue. That's been a hot topic, the pros and cons of profiling.
Right. And many people think, in fact, Vince can address that as well. But in our book, we looked at, can you profile? And you can't. But you can profile behavior, and you have to profile behavior. And you have to look at certain things. You know, just because somebody is wearing Muslim garb or clothing, that doesn't necessarily make them a terrorist. But it's what they're doing in that clothing that does. Do you want to address that too, Mr. Sullivan?
Yeah, there's no more of a landmine than that word in law enforcement. Profile. I refuse to drop it. I think the profiling is something that we all do. When we came out of the cave, the first thing we learned to do is to size people up on the horizon. Is that friend or foe? And we still do it. We have to do it. So that's really all profiling is. Now, we all know that we can make mistakes and we can jump to conclusions before it's time to jump to the conclusion. I liken it. I was an attorney in a previous life, and in the courtroom, the jury is listening to countless pieces of evidence come in, and they're weighing them each and deciding whether or not they're going to accept them as part of the case or how probative they are. But at some point, they reach the standard. In the civil case, it's a preponderance of the evidence, and in the criminal case, it's beyond a reasonable doubt. But then it's time to draw a conclusion. And in all of these endeavors, even in science, we never absolutely know anything, but at some point, we have to bust the move, as they say, and say, I believe this is a problem. So when Jeff Bauman was creeped out by this guy, all he had to do, he didn't have to attack him, he didn't have to shoot him, but he should have at least moved away from that backpack. The San Bernardino shooting, neighbors said that they saw unusual, suspicious activity at the home of the couple, but didn't report it because they were afraid of being considered racially insensitive or even racist. Well, they didn't have to call the police and say, there's some brown people that live next door, we're uncomfortable about that. All they had to do was describe the behavior they were seeing. We see a number of men who don't live there at the wee hours of the morning unloading all kinds of things in the garage, and they're all looking over their shoulder the whole time to see if they're being observed.
Wow.
That's profiling, but it's profiling, as Dr. Glass said, behavior, not just race. So we have to get beyond this injunction that some people are trying to put on us, that we can't see things and we can't name what we see. We have to do that.
For another program, the Attorney General Lynch is discouraging anybody openly on reporting anything. Yeah, see something, say something, but it better not be a Muslim. So of the last 3,000 terrorist attacks around the world, 2,900 were Muslims. So we're not out there looking for a tall Swedish nun. We're looking for fundamental Muslims.
Are now doing time in prison. I wouldn't say nuns. There's Jihad Jane and Jihad Jamie. Very attractive. A lot of these young women, we've seen this, the young women going to ISIS, 17, 18 years old, and they're running away from home, and they're joining ISIS to be with these men that they meet online. And when they get there, they realize, uh-oh, it's too late. You know, they realize they made a big mistake. So there are a lot more women terrorists. In fact, in the San Bernardino terrorist attack, there was a woman there, Tafsin Malik. And so, you know, you really are seeing so many more. So, you know, so as far as what they look like and who they are, I agree with you that there may be the ones that we're aware of, maybe from the Middle East, maybe there's a greater extent, but we cannot neglect that there are other types of terrorists. We have to look at everybody, even children. I mean, it's one of the things we did in the research of the book. It was shocking that a lot of these terrorist organizations are using little kids to plant them with bombs and suicide materials. People that have disabilities, people that are in wheelchairs. So when you go to the airport and you say, oh, why are they picking on that poor little old lady in a wheelchair? Well, you know what? Everything has to be looked at.
To your point, Doctor, good point. Bader Meinhof was a German terrorist group back in the day, of course, in Germany, primarily women. We were chasing them around Germany and Europe. They were proper terrorists looking for a political gain by definition. And Bader Meinhof was made up mostly of girls. Interesting. Backpack, what do you think, sir?
Voices of Global Freedom, MagnifyView.com. We have body language expert Dr. Lillian Glass and teams up with D. Vincent Sullivan, former FBI special agent, to write the book Body Language of Terrorists. How can our audience find your book and other websites?
Yeah, it's easy to find. All you have to do is go to Amazon.com. VoGFR.com, put in body language of terrorists, and you can get the book either in electronic form, ebook, or you can get it on your computer, or you can get it an actual physical copy of it. And it's reasonably priced, and it can really help you save your life. And the people that you love, people that you care about, especially people that live away from you, that you want to feel that they're safe, and you can get that. And if you want more information about some of the other books that I've written a book called Body Language of Liars, Toxic People, and you can look at my website, which is just my name, www.drlilienglass.com.
Backpack's going to feature you far and wide with his shop. We ask only that you promote the magnifiedview.com and Voices of Global Freedom somewhere on your website.
We'll do our best.
Special Agent Sullivan, what are you doing now for a crust of bread? We couldn't find that on the internet.
Well, after retirement, I secured a job in the pharmaceutical industry, but now I'm pretty much walking my dog and working on this book with Dr.
I think what we're doing right now is we're really going to be doing a lot of lecturing, and that's kind of the future of this. We're going to be lecturing to police departments across the country, as well as to law enforcement agencies and government agencies. So our aim is to really focus on getting this message out to the world, and we're going to be doing that. So that's what I'm doing with my part of my career, a strong part of it now, as well as Mr. Sullivan doing the same thing.
Backpack mentioned our fond friend Lieutenant Sutton earlier out of Vegas. He's on the ascendancy. He's featured on a TV program, and he's running around the country defending the shield. We will refer you pair to Randy Sutton, and I'm sure he'll be helping you as well. So we'll do that after this recording.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure talking to you, and I have to say that when you listen to a person's voice, you can tell a great deal about them, and you have the most marvelous voice and with such charisma, and I wish you so much success in your radio and what you do, because you're doing a good service as well.
Thanks for the compliment, Doctor. I'm glowing. I'm the luckiest guy in the world. Went into the Air Force at 14. Mother ratted me out in Korea. Went into the Army. I was a cop. You know, I've done what I
wanted. You've done it all.
I've done what I wanted with who and where, including this minute with you and Super Special Agent Sullivan. Luckiest guy in the world. Well, how's our time,
thank you again, and we appreciate your time and effort in promoting our book. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Happy New Year.
Very special, Sullivan. Bye. Thanks indeed. Really like to know you in person. We're going to be running you with some regularity. Wrap it up for us. Very special agent.
Well, our book is an attempt by us to arm, if you will, the citizenry, how to keep themselves safer, and by them being more observant, they will be a force multiplier to law enforcement out there. They need help, they need our help, and we need to be more savvy and smarter about the dangerous world we now live in. And I know a lot of people would not like to have to think that we should be doing these things, but we do, and we need to step up, put on big boy pants, and be savvy, aware, observant citizens.
Well said, sir. Thank you, folks, indeed. It's been a great show. It'll air this Saturday at 4 Pacific, then throughout our 8, 9, 10 syndicates. I don't know. It'll continue to air ad infinitum around the world through these things, through these syndicates. They'll pick it up and run with it through the week and the next week and like that. Well, Backpack, what do you think, brother?
Yeah, great show. Thank you for being on. I started looking through the book. It's excellent read. So I recommend it for our audience and everybody to go take a look at Body Language of Terrorists.
All right. Thank
you very much for that.
Be safe, guys.
Dr. Lillian Glass.
Be safe.
The conference.
Thank you.
All right. What a great update from Dr. Glass and D. Vincent Sullivan.
Good stuff, Backpack. I would add, of course, in a static environment where things aren't moving, look for people that are moving. In a moving environment, look for somebody standing still. Two kind of people really watch other people, good guys and bad guys. I know half the population says they're people watchers, but most of those don't know what to look for. So look for people that are watching people. Look for motion in a static environment and look for staying still in a place where people should be moving. Most of all, look for people that are watching other people is a good surveillance tip. And you'll find bad guys. Sometimes you'll find good guys because they look for other people at other people also.
We want to say hello to everybody in the chat room. Lady Michelle, Mary, Annie with Southern Sense Talk Radio, and Flycatch. We were just on Annie's show. Southern-sense.com is the website. Yesterday, great show. Go check it out. And it's great to have you in the chat room. Flycatch has an update for all of us. He just heard a story about a Muslim terrorist on a hoverboard who blew up, apparently. Wow. Have you heard that yet, Yoda?
No, couldn't happen to a better person.
They're going...
Janorama, founding editor-in-chief, Magnified View, just picked up a sketchy story. There was a mass shooting, four or more, in a school yesterday in Saskatchewan, Canada. Young male perpetrator, 17, started shooting people. Nothing further on that. It's going to come more and more, of course. We have, as you covered in our Magnified News headlines today, the storm in the East Coast that's involving about a quarter of the U.S. population. So most of them weren't prepared, of course. At the last minute, they go out and buy 12 gallons of milk. I don't know what they're going to do with that. They buy 12 loaves of bread and clean out the store shelves. Happening right now in the East Coast backpack, so we need to be a bit prepared. That's a big one.
We do have an update on weather.com. It says snow totals have topped 30 inches in at least four states as winter storm Jonas continues to hammer parts of the mid-Atlantic and northeast regions with near blizzard conditions. Coastal flooding and winds over 70 miles per hour in some coastal areas. So it's quite a storm.
Yeah, the floods are the big one. They take most loss of life and most loss of property, so wish people would be prepared. Here's what we see coming down the pike. Our incredible guest lineup in the past, present, and coming on soon. Would you name a bunch of those, please?
Lieutenant General Michael T. Flynn, former head of Defense Intelligence Agency, over 17,000 employees. Lieutenant Colonel Alan B. West, and our good friend, Major General Paul E. Vallely. He is the chairman of Stand Up America. He is a two-star general, served our country well over 30 years in the U.S. Army, retired as one of the heads of the Pacific Fleet. Incredible background, but please go check out standupamericaus.org. I say again, standupamericaus.org. Yoda and the good General Vallely just talked on the phone recently, and I was thinking in my mind, a couple of warriors having a chat. It was incredible to hear both of them to be a fly on the wall and hear that conversation.
One really old warrior, that would be me. He's quite a guy, really. They broke the mold with him also. That Stand Up America is doing the job, aren't they?
Yeah, they really are. Welcome Iris Pectu, who just joined us in the chat room. Feel free to engage us in the audience, in the chat room, and call us at 646-652-4667. Call in to hear the show and or talk to the host, Yoda and Backpack. I got to ask Flycatch in our chat room a question. How did you get the name Flycatch? Been curious about that.
Good on you.
Interesting handle.
It is.
So Flycatch actually just made us aware of a new resolution in Congress. It's H.R. Resolution 569, where it's basically not allowing any Americans to speak out against the Muslims. So we want to tell our audience and tell everybody, tell all your friends to veto this new H.R. 569. It basically takes a chunk away from our freedom of speech and our First Amendment rights.
Well, there it goes. And these silly correct people, the politically correct now, just can't wait to give up their freedom of speech, can't they? They don't know what the hell they're saying. They're afraid to say anything.
Yeah, Yoda just has a brilliant quote about political correctness. What was that? Please tell our audience. He gets credit for this one.
I don't remember it, darn it. I'd love to get credit.
We just tweeted it out. We'll follow up that in a little bit. All we got about 35 minutes left. We do have a caller. Let's see if they're Peristai Milton. You're live with Voices of Global Freedom.
Oh, hi there. Hi there. How are you?
We're good. How are you?
I'm good. Just surviving a terrible storm in Manhattan.
Where are you calling from?
New York City.
Oh, boy. Our heart's with you.
I'm telling you, I thought New York was collapsed last night. You should have heard what it sounded like, not just seen it. I put it on videotape because I just thought we were going to collapse. But I don't know what we're hearing when we have these storms. So we've been having some very strange activity. I don't know if it's terrorism or some other unusual phenomena. But
I hope you're safe and cozy and comfortable, are you?
Oh, I couldn't be better. I'm telling you, it's nice to be in a nice modern apartment, semi-modern at least.
Wonderful.
It's a big building. Yeah. And very secure, but somehow New York seems very flimsy in a storm of that power, if you know what I'm saying.
We've been in them around the world, and civilization is indeed fragile, isn't it? How did you hear about Voices of Global Freedom?
Yeah, I just hope, I don't know, I felt like I was in a house of cards, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
That's how strong the storm was next to my big building.
Do you still have electricity?
You know what, I'm very fortunate. I almost feel guilty. We have our own generators, so even if it was a blackout, I don't think we'd have a problem. We didn't have one during Sandy. I was like pretty much the person to go to instead of charge your radios or cell phones. I'm a good person to know in New York, you know.
Yeah.
Send us your video if you'd like. Send it to radio@magnifiedview.com.
Yeah, it's great that we live in this social media time where we can hear from people right on the ground what's really going on. So how many inches of snow did New York City get?
Yeah, Sonny, we're going to break our record, or anyone's record, I believe, in about an hour. We've had 27 inches, and they're putting their odds that if we don't break it in an hour, it's going to be at least, we're going to break it, like, that's for sure.
Two questions.
Yeah.
How'd you hear about our radio program? Then what are you seeing out your window now?
Well, I'll tell you in a minute. I looked under science. Because I like to read about science, anything scientific. And then I saw you, and of course, we all have a fear of terrorism after 9/11 and after Paris. I have family in Paris. One of them was shot. So I have just two reasons to be paranoid about terrorism, and they're very justifiable, you know. So I
wore a helmet in Vietnam in two languages. On the helmet, I had inscribed paranoid hell, these so-and-sos are trying to kill me.
You're so right, paranoid hell, right? I mean, you had, call it paranoid, it's so justified, you know?
Yeah, what do you see out your window?
Well, I can see some very odd things out my window. I don't want to scare you or make you think I'm crazy. I don't usually film out my window because I feel like I'm being watched. This cog here? No, anyway.
Movement out there? Anything moving around?
Yeah, things are moving. Cog knows me. He knows I see a lot of activity. You have to give me your website again before I could send. I could just send you what happened last night. That was just, I was taping it off and on. I left it on for hours. I usually wind up going downstairs when I feel like maybe my building is going to, you know, get hit by another building. It just started sounding like crumbling. I could tell you the truth, and you could hear it. When I hear that sound, I want to get out of my tall building. I just don't want to be in a building that gets whatever. So I don't. There's a McDonald's downstairs. I usually get egg McMuffin. Yeah. Take a look at my smartphone, see if everything's still standing, and then I'm sure everything's safe.
Thank you for the call. It's great to get updates like this.
New York City.
Stay with us on the phone, and you'll hear the rest of the show. We're going to talk more about how to be prepared in any kind of human or natural disaster. So stay with us. Thanks for joining us. We've got some new people. Cog joined us in the chat room, and Iris Peck, too, and some others. So it's great to have new people with us. So we have an exclusive MagnifiedView.com article. And back to parasites, or I'm not pronouncing her name right, I think. Milton, we'll call Milton. You can find us on radio at magnifiedview.com. So send us that YouTube that you have of what's going on in New York City from the ground level. And we have an article called Run, Hide, Fight that we can talk about on magnifiedview.com.
Go backpack.
Yeah, the first area is if you see the ISIS, Islam, Muslim, active shooter, terrorist attacks on America. So the title is ISIS, active shooter, terrorist attacks on America. 2 days before the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI, declares the San Bernardino, California massacre a terrorist incident, the Islamic ideologue abomination put the country at risk once again, alluding to the incident as workplace violence. Our Yoda and Backpack are bringing the force here to patriotic United States citizens. We have an article, Run, Hide, Fight. Yoda's actionable individual security tactics on entering public venues, shopping malls, theaters, sports stadiums, churches, concerts, and other soft targets. Observe and mentally take note of the locations of all the exits. So the first category is run. In the event of fire, earthquake, even blizzards, or entrance of any Islamic Jihad active shooter, immediately run for an exit. Put as much distance between you and the shooter as quickly as you can.
Let me help you. Let me work with you. In hotels, as you get your hotel room, count the number of doors to an exit you can walk down. Anywhere you enter, find a way to get out of there, multiple exits, and take a mental note of where they're at. So it'll become automatic. You'll see more good things as well. So first thing to do, anywhere you're at in public venues, especially a hotel, count the number of doors down to the stairway. Don't be in hotel rooms over 10 floors high. Why? Because if you have a ladder unit in the fire department, that's as high as they go. Count the doors down. Throw a little flashlight in your door key in your shoes at night. Anyway, enough with that. Take note of the exits. Over to Backpack.
Yeah, as Cog points out in the chat room just now, this is being situationally aware. This is what we call this. And so the odds of an active shooter hitting you with a rifle past 20 feet are in your favor. So if you can run in a zigzag fashion, if that is one of the run, hide, fight scenarios. The second one is
applies today also to an armed robbery. If you're robbed with a gun or whatever you're robbed with, take out your wallet, appear to fumble and drop it in front of them and run. Back in the old street days, you were likely to be robbed with a gun. They'd take your money and watch and off they'd go. The odds of these screwballs today shooting you anyway are pretty high. As Radio Chick Annie, used to be a cop in New York, will attest that it's a different world today. So if you need to run in a zigzag pattern, the odds of their hitting you is small. The odds of their hitting a vital organ in you is smaller. So as quick as you can increase the range or distance, the better off you're going to be. Backpack.
Yeah, the second category is hide. So cover and concealment. Should you be unable to run for any reason, hide behind something that would stop a bullet. This is called cover. Go to a closet, put your cell phone on vibrate, or turn it off. This ringing cell phone will disclose your location. Lacking cover, finding concealment behind a chair, bush, of anything that might conceal you from a shooter.
Excellent. So cover, indeed, is something that will stop a bullet. Concealment is something you hide behind. Cover is both, of course, always. It's concealment as well. Love what you said. Get into that closet or some little room. Close and lock the door. Quit making noise. Get that cell phone off. Likelihood of the bad guy moving on to an easier thing is very high.
The third category is fight. If unable to run or find cover and concealment, attack the shooter with any impact weapon available. We call it weapons of opportunity. Sometimes a chair, a cup, saucer, telephone, even a ballpoint pen, it can be a weapon if you need to. If possible, wait until the shooter is reloading his or her pistol, rifle, or shotgun being attacked before attacking the shooter. So there's lots of weapons of opportunities all around you if you know how to look for them or just be aware of them in those types of situations. The San Bernardino attack was one of our most recent terror attacks.
Yeah, and our heroes on that train, Amsterdam to France, acted on it. They attacked, didn't they?
Yeah, that's a great point. We had the three Americans on that Paris train that, unfortunately, the story turned out to be a good one, but it could have been very different. This guy, the bad guy, the Islam Muslim terrorist, had an arsenal. He even had box cutters. I believe the Air Force cadet, he actually defended off and got cut by this box cutter.
Pretty heroic.
Yeah.
We're recommending. There are flashlights out now. Pretty little, actually. They're sturdy. Called tactical flat. Well, everything's tactical, as Annie would know. But they're a good impact weapon, meaning you can hold it in your hand and knock somebody up beside the head. They're easily fit into a pocket or a purse. Have it out at the first sign of a problem. It's something you won't have to do later. Pepper spray's good. They all have their limitations. I'm not a taser guy at all. People, you've got to be too close to the bad guy, and people often electrocute themselves, so that's not good.
Yeah, take immediate action. Do not sit like a duck in a pond waiting to be slaughtered. Despite logic and expert to the contrary, schools across the nation are locking down, pinning our kids up in their classrooms in neat, orderly fashion, waiting for the active shooter. Were kids be allowed to scatter outside running different directions, it would save most of them. So the only thing that would save victims from assault by active shooters are good guys and good girls armed with guns.
That's the truth. How would the outcome have been different had people in San Bernardino in that party had some business? Watch our good friend Sheriff Arpaio, toughest sheriff in America, Maricopa County, Phoenix. What's he up to now?
Currently in Metro Phoenix, there's about 250,000 with people with CCWs, concealed carry weapon permits, and he's calling for all the people to actually sign up and get CCWs so that they can be out, when they're out and about, that they can actually have a gun and use it to save countless others.
Good news. I picked up that the police chief in Milwaukee, you see him on Fox a lot, or the sheriff, whatever he is, sheriff in Polk County, Florida, and other police chiefs are joining with Arpaio now. So as you said, Backpack, the only thing stopping a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. What the hell are these gun-free zones about? What was Aurora called? You were there.
I was at the Aurora Theater shortly after it was. The terrorist came in and killed a lot of people. And he went to seven other theaters, but they all had strict gun control, or they all had gun available areas. So he specifically chose that Aurora Theater because it was a soft target, and they didn't allow guns inside the theater. But I got to see all the bloodied seats when they pulled them out of the theater, and I saw the police tape
That's true.
It was there.
I think you meant to say that the other ones were gun-free zones, right?
Yeah.
Right.
You weren't allowed to have guns in those other theaters.
How many of them? How many other theaters?
Before he went to the Roar one, he checked out seven other theaters, and they were all you could have guns there, yeah. But he specifically just went to the one where you weren't allowed guns. He chose that theater.
Makes sense to me.
Yeah.
I don't really understand that stupidity. What's that mall and what's our sports stadium here?
Oh, yeah. We also hear of a report that the Mall of America, the largest mall, I believe, in the world, and the Qualcomm Stadium in San Diego, if you're an off-duty officer, you're not allowed to have guns when you go to that stadium. And, you know, as a bare minimum, we should allow also off-duty officers to have guns.
From the top now, our incredible lineup of guests on and off air, each and every one are predicting active shooters this year in the United States as they are bombing incidents. So in my opinion, the abomination, our procrastinator in chief, is really encouraging this. He's leaving the border open. He's desperately shutting down Guantanamo, letting terrorists go back to the battlefield. He's bringing in Syrians, where some percentage of them clearly are ISIS terrorists. He's throwing open the prison doors to federal prisons. Some states are copying him now on what they call early odds. This is in an environment of fewer cops, because the cities and counties now are lacking tax revenue because of the economy. They're actually laying off cops. They're laying off deputy sheriffs. So there's fewer of them out there than should be. Then there's fewer of them. So you're going to be on your own in the next event, especially a natural disaster like now on the East Coast. You know, cops can't get there. They're in the same trouble as our great caller called from her apartment in New York back.
Yeah, it is incredible this day and age with social media that we can get calls like from New York City, from anywhere really in the world. We recently had a call from South Africa too, which was really incredible to get, you know, just that we're so able to connect so easily now.
We are living large. So people need to be a bit prepared. You have our favorite Dr. Bones and Nurse Amy coming on, don't you?
Yeah, we're excited next week. Go check out doomandbloom.net. I say again, doomandbloom.net. We're going to have Dr. Bones and Nurse Amy, who are exclusive preppers. They teach everybody about how to be prepared in any kind of natural or human disaster. So we're excited to have them.
From a medical point of view.
Exactly.
From experience around the world in natural and terrorist disasters and wars, I've been in wars they didn't have names for. The first problem is really medical. Cars are running into each other, major injury accidents, people are having heart attacks, they're running into walls, they're fighting with each other, people have run out of critical maintenance meds, like heart patients, diabetic people. So it's not the pseudo-glamorous, what kind of gun should you have? That's a lot less important than learning some basic medical skills. Because when the active shooter happens, or when a big enough event happens in a major city, that's going to eliminate store shelves. So you're not going to run out and get your Band-Aids 1 minute after an incident is too late to start preparing. You need the medical knowledge, and you need a kit. So listen for the program upcoming and take a look at Doom and Bloom.
Yeah, our friends at doomandbloom.net, they're going to be with us once again. They were just on The Blaze with Glenn Beck, so they're coming on Voices of Global Freedom for their second reappearance. You can find them also in our archives on Voices of Global Freedom if you just Google that. And Doom and Bloom, great people to work with.
Useful, practical stuff. isn't it?
Yeah, it really is. We're also next week going to be talking with Ryan Morrow, who is with the Clarion Project. He is one of the national security analysts that you'll see on Fox News and numerous over 100 media appearances. So he's a great guy to work with, too. Ryan Morrow, he'll be coming up. So stay tuned for that.
Well, we're betting with our stunning guest lineup, as our audience readily knows in the chat room, we're not the professional slick radio guys. We're a couple guys that find ourselves on radio with incredible guests back then.
Yeah, please go check out magnifiedview.com. I say again, magnifiedview.com. That's our sister Millions circulated magazine. Got well over 4 million views last year in 2015. We're looking to double that to 8 million in 2016. And also globalfreedomradio.com, and our YouTube channel is Global Freedom Network as the username there. So you can see a lot of our archives, and also here on Blog Talk Radio, Voices of Global Freedom.
I'd like to address Islam. The word means submission, and that's what it's about. There is a caliphate, means taking over the world, putting everybody in submission, getting some ground now in Syria and Iraq. You, despite what everybody's saying, you can't be a Muslim with a small M. You can be a Catholic with a small C. You can go to church with your mother once a year on Easter Day. Islam, submission, takes up every molecule of their being, every moment of their wretched lives. And that includes the ones that quietly walk among us here. What's your word for deception that they use in Arabic?
Well, it's called taqiyya. In translation, it means taqiyya, is what we call it. But the translation is, it means they can lie and deceive people so that Islam can take over the world and have a global caliphate. Their version of the New World Order is that Islam is everywhere in the world. The Muslim population is 20% of the world out of 80. So the other 80% is just fighting to survive. The other 20%.
Growing, isn't it?
Yeah, they're having like 20 to 50 kids in each of these families with four or five wives. Wow.
Recent survey is a big survey in the United States. 90-odd% of them want Sharia law. That's where you suborn the women, you dress them in garbage bags, genital, you know the rest. So almost 100% of them have to say they prefer Sharia law, which they do. 25%+ of them found that suicide bombing is a pretty cool idea to foster the caliphate. So this information is readily available if you'll search the net. Don't take my word for it. Look on the net for documented facts about Islam. They need by order to kill us or convert us. And I'm going to remain an infidel. Backpack, look at the invasion of Europe today.
Yeah, it has gotten outrageous. We've seen a teenager from Germany who's afraid to even go outside because she was terrorized at her local supermarket by the Muslim invaders. They were all staring her down and whispering. And, you know, it's just horrific what's happening in Europe.
Well, documented now in Germany on New Year's Eve alone, from Hamburg in the north through Dortmund, Dusseldorf, famous one is Cologne or Köln, down past Munich in the south, they have documented 500 rapes and physical attacks on women folk on New Year's Eve alone. This didn't get out for weeks because the left press there, it left as our press, suppressed it, and the government suppressed it, but the word's finally out now on day 22 or whatever it is in January. These savages are ordered, they're compelled, they must run out and rape a bunch of women. Can you imagine that mindset to get up today and say, I've got a duty to join a couple hundred guys, we're going to go rape a bunch of girls? What the hell kind of mindset is that back there?
Well, since 7th century Islam and 21st century kind of thinking, like we are, we can't even wrap our minds around these savages and these barbarians. But one of the things that rang in the new year on New Year's Eve 2015, a story that's not getting out there on mainstream media, is that there was 1,000 rapes in Cologne, Germany, by innocent, Germans were raped. And so this is a story that needs to get out there far and wide.
Well, they're in it now. All of the country, Western Europe, are in trouble. They don't know what to do with the refugees. They're running around with knives, accosting men and women. Hell, they're raping men. This is all available for you, fine audience, without which we wouldn't exist. Take a look at the internet. Look at AP. Look at Reuters. Look at other solid sources. Europe's in a lot of trouble. Hell, the Swedes, the poster country for diversity and all that jive, they're in really in trouble. Taking a serious look at becoming an Islamic state. It's, I've spent half of my life at least in Europe, and I just can't deal with it. Who was Larry Johnson we had on?
He's former CIA. He was with the he's an incredible archive of his interview on Voices of Global Freedom.
He was recently in Germany and France, where I live, and told us on air, that I wouldn't even recognize it anymore. The ragheads running around, the lights are off, it's become dirty. What a thought, man. I got to get back over and see what it's like. So Europe is in trouble with this invasion. They simply don't know what the hell to do with them. Well, what would you do with them?
Yeah, that's true. We're seeing a lot of that happening as we're following the news. We'd like to see mainstream media talking about some of the issues that we talk about on Voices of Global Freedom.
Well, we're not. What would we do? And Annie might comment on this from the chat room. What do we do in a city if 500 of them show up? They connect, of course, through a fishbone communication through cell phone. What do we do if 500 of them show up in a major city and start raping our women folk? What the hell do, well, I know. The city then calls for mutual aid from departments in the suburbs. So many places, oh, that'll bring 50, 60 coppers together. What do they do up against 1,000, as happened in Cologne?
Well, one of the best defenses we can have with that is just like what Sheriff Joe Arpaio, Phoenix, Maricopa County said, is we want to have people well-trained, but also have weapons out there on the street, have their firearms and their guns. That's our some of our best line of defense.
These savages are going in supermarkets all over Europe, again, available and legitimate sources on the internet. They invade a supermarket. They treat it like a cafeteria. They start eating stuff out of the deli, not paying for it. Then they eliminate their waste in a corner somewhere while harassing women. And men. Well, hell, they'd rape a rhesus monkey if they were in the zoo. So that's going on now in astounding large extent throughout Europe. And it's being kept quiet. On Fox, the Trump network, I've only seen it brought up twice. That was by O'Reilly, kind of skimmed over it twice the other night. So being kept quiet. Question, backpack. We've got all kinds of them here, and Obama's bringing in more every day that he can. I am outraged at his end-of-the-year speech. Democrats brought in CARE members to the damn speech. CARE, what is it, Council of American Islamic Relations, a part of the Muslim Brotherhood terrorist organization, have been convicted of conspiracy to terrorism. But the damn congressmen and senators literally brought CARE members to the end of the year speech. Where is it going, Beckman?
Well, we want to rename CARE to be Council on American Islamic Caliphate Takeover. That's really what they are. that we see them also in bed with the Muslim Brotherhood, which is the world's oldest terrorist group that was formed in the late 1920s. It's really a bad group. That gets back to also that Obama supported Muslim Brotherhood to take over Egypt. And fortunately, al-Sisi became in charge. He had to come back and take it over from Morsi. And I believe Morsi and his minions are rotting in a prison right now.
Point well made. If you look at the president's schedule, it's on the internet, you'll see he frequently meets with Brotherhood members without press. I don't think they're playing pinochle.
No, they're not. We know they've been around for a long time, coming up on 100 years. This organization is just really nasty. And stay aware. Check out the internet. Stay apprised. We have another breaking story about Obama. We're not hearing on mainstream media that Obama is actually releasing God knows thousands of drug dealers and gangbangers into our streets who don't have jobs or any means to support themselves, and nobody will hire these people. Additionally, they're doing drugs and crimes, and they will need to. They're going to go back to drugs and crimes to supply these newly released criminals.
That's what they do. Don't miss our show Wednesday, people. We're proud that by popular demand, we're starting a Wednesday show. Started it this week, went really well, so the audience said. How's our time back then?
Well, we've got about 4 minutes left. It does go fast here.
Tell me what your book's about. What's it doing?
You can find my book. It's called Looking Glass Shattered, Cubicle Commando to Constitutional Conservative Leader. It's available on Amazon, Kindle. You can look it up now. It's a great book about my travels and my odyssey across America over the last, coming up on 5 years in April of 2016. It's all my adventures and risks that I took. By getting rid of all my stuff, I got my nickname Backpack and just hit the road, doing the Appalachian Trail, parts of that, crisscrossing from sea to sea, shining sea, and coast to coast across America.
Backpack was a advanced computer guy. Work Center for Disease Control, everybody, Northrop Grumman, other premier Fortune 500 corporations, made a lot of money to sit in his cubicle, whatever they do there, and looked up at a wonderful poster about mountain climbing. So he did it. Gave away a lot of his stuff, sold some of his stuff, stuck it in the backpack, and off he went. 4 years interviewing everybody, became a broadcast journalist out there, walking with kings but not losing the common touch, said Kipling. Anyway. Good job, Backpack. Book selling well?
Yeah, it's doing really well. So go check out Looking Glass Shattered, Cubicle Commando to Constitutional Conservative Leader. I'm glad I lived to tell the tale. A lot of harrowing adventures and risks that I took, undercover work that I had with a gang of Sudanese bad guys. And it's how I got to meet up with MagnifyView.com and the intelligence team and Yoda and Jan Arama, to the editor-in-chief of MagnifyView.com.
Well, our privilege to have you. We're not going to let you get away. So show's coming back on Wednesday. More incredible guests coming on. We've got George Saleti coming on. I think a lot of you know of him. Trend forecast guy. He's coming on. Zen Gardner, other heavies are coming on. We're working closely with Bubba Horowitz, our exclusive financial guy, working closely with General Bilaley. We're having lunch Tuesday with who?
We're having lunch with our good friend, Colonel Najjar, who is with Stand Up America. He's the Middle East expert. We're going to get the best knowledge from the Middle East from him. He is from Lebanon background, and he's unbelievable. Go check out Stand Up America. US.org. You can learn more about Colonel Najjar on the website that we work with.
He and the good recently in Paris at the Russian embassy meeting privately with Putin's emissary. That's pretty big league, Backpack.
Yeah, it'll be a great meeting of the minds, and we're going to learn a lot more about what's really going on in the Middle East. We are seeing Iran is pretty much taking over the entire Middle East with Russia's help.
So, are they ever? Caliphate.
So we're seeing Iran as a, we want to hear more about the threats of Iran from our mainstream media. So thanks. I want to thank our audience. Thank you all in the chat room. Southern Sense, Annie, Lady Michelle, Mary, Flycatch, Cog, all the guys. Great to have you on with us.
See you Wednesday.
See you Wednesday, 4 to 6 Pacific.